session, only I came to know that the network has been disconnected. So since I put my mobile in the silent mode also, I couldn't get the from organizer as well as some of the participants, those who have my contact number. So no problem. Where I have left, that is where my video gets disconnected. At that point, I will start the presentation. So anyhow, to refresh the morning presentation, a little bit I will go into the from the first slide until the point where I have left. So morning we started giving introduction about why the word deep neural network is introduced as against the existing neural networks that are used conventionally before the invent of this particular model. So they are treated as shallow network, and this kind of network what we are going to see today is treated as deep neural network. So I have given you the difference between the shallow neural network and deep neural network with respect to architecture and with respect to some operation. And with respect to pattern recognition task, I have given you the difference between shallow neural network and deep neural network. That is, in shallow neural network, only the recognition task can be done. Whereas in deep neural network, both the feature extraction as well as the recognition task, that may be any classification task, can be done. And I have given you the idea of how much depth the neural network is. That is, how much deep the neural network is at each level. The input layer is deep, hidden layer is deep, and the output layer is also treated as deep. For a simple case study, face recognition problem. As against the face recognition task that we have discussed in the yesterday session, this is a little more advanced and a more accurate form of producing the result. Then I introduced the concept of deep neural networks, that is basic as well as the more important key concepts. Followed by that, I introduced what is deep learning and what are the networks that is following the deep learning, convolutional neural network and recurrent neural network. Remember, when you go for deep learning neural network, the data that is should be supplied to the model is unstructured data in the form of images or any scanned documents or files containing any audio or video. So to start with, the concept of conventional neural network is introduced, in which three layers have been discussed. Its architecture have been discussed with the four main operations. They are convolution, non-linearity, that is activation operation, pooling operation, and classification operation. So I introduced the way in which the convolution operation has been carried out. I hope you understand the idea behind the convolution operation. Then I introduced this operation, that is ReLU, that is activation operation. So in activation operation, whenever a matrix is given, the pixel values are red. Wherever negative pixel value is there, in that position, zero is replaced and the positive is retained as such. So this is the output of ReLU operation. So followed by this, the another important operation is pooling operation. In the convolution operation, as well as in the ReLU operation, the feature map size doesn't reduce. It is kept as such. Only thing, some kind of operation has been happened as explained previously. Whereas in the pooling operation, some kind of sampling has been done. So it is mostly down sampling because the purpose is to reduce the dimension of the data. So imagine a matrix of this form, which is the output of the convolution operation, followed by the ReLU operation. Now, in order to apply pooling operation, you have to define a stride, that is the scanning window, which is of size 2, you can choose any size, but to illustrate, here the size 2 is taken. So it is a 2 cross 2 matrix size we are going to form with the help of the stride by applying the operation max. That means each 4 elements in the image matrix have to be scanned like this. The first matrix submatrix that is scanned from the image matrix is 1, 2, 6, 4. Out of the 4 elements, that is pixel elements, which is greater 6. So 6 is printed here. Then the scan is moved to the next 4 elements, 3, 2, 7, 6. Out of this, 7 is greater element, it is printed. Likewise, it goes up to this third quadrant and fourth quadrant. So the given matrix is divided into quadrants according to the size of stride. And the stride is moved over each quadrant. While moving over the quadrant, in order to conduct the pooling operation, we have to check whether it is maximum pooling operation or average pooling operation. Since the slide explains you the maximum pooling operation, the number 6 is printed and number 7 is printed and number 8 is printed in the third quadrant and number 9 is printed in the fourth quadrant. I hope you understand the pooling operation. Likewise, for every future map, the pooling operation has been conducted. Next, classification. So classification is similar to the one that I have explained in the past 2 days, especially in the yesterday session. Here also the same kind of task is conducted here, but the layer that is responsible for this task is classification layer. Fully connected layer. So this fully connected layer is a flat feedforward neural network layer that have a function that is in general, you have an activation function or otherwise you call by the name softmax activation function, which is used to predict the probabilities of the classification layer. That is in the yesterday session, lab session, I explained, we have two variables, Y2 and small y. Y2 is the actual output and Y is the network output that is created with the help of sim command. That sim command created network output is nothing but values containing between zeros and ones, and they are called as class probabilities. Those values are displayed here after performing all the maximum convolutional operation and the pooling operation repeatedly under various stages. So finally, you got an output. That output is processed in the fully connected layer with the help of activation function and softmax function, and it is fed into the output layer. So the output layer, if you could see, there are 4 stack. Each stack is responsible for a particular recognition output. The first stack says that it is dog. Second stack says that it is cat. Third stack says that it is deer. Fourth stack says that it is lion. Associated with each class label, there are class probabilities. Dog is 0.1%, that is 0.1. Cat 0.4, deer 0.94, lion 0.2. So like yesterday's lab class, with the help of a threshold value 0.5, if I discriminate these values, then definitely I could get in the first stack 0, second tag also 0, third one is 1 since it is more than 0.5, and fourth one 0. So the final output for the given input is deer. So in such a way, the classification task is conducted in the fully connected layer. So to summarize the operation of CNN, what is the first step? We have to submit the input. So remember, for CNN, the input is always an image. So then the convolution operation and the pooling operations are executed one by one with various stages. During the convolution operation, you have to apply the ReLU operation also. So after feeding the input image into the convolution layer, before execution, you have to decide the size of the stride and the padding operation. Then you have to perform the convolution operation on the image. After that, you have to do ReLU operation. Then followed by the convolution and ReLU operation, you have to perform pooling operation that is sampling, or otherwise called by the name dimensional reduction, to reduce the future map size. Then this convolution operation, pooling operations have been conducted as many as layers as possible until you expect the desired accuracy. Then at one time you entered into fully connected layers. This fully connected layer is doing the operation of classification, and finally it enters into the output layer with the class conditional probabilities by the help of softmax function. So from the class conditional probabilities, what you have to do is you have to decide the final value based on the class conditional probabilities. Look at this image. The image that is given is to be identified by the CNN. What is the image available in this picture? Whether it is tree or cat or house or boat. As explained in the previous slide, here also there are four stack available. The first stack says that it is boat with a confidence of 0.04. The second stack says that it is house with a confidence of 0.05. The third stack says that it is tree with a probability value 0.9, and it goes for cat it is 0.01. So here you have to apply the threshold value. Maybe I can assign some 0.5. More than that it is 0. More than that it is 1. Less than that it is 0. So final output is for boat 0, for house 0, for tree 1, and for cat 0. So the final output from the input image is tree. So likewise, the other images also, the CNN has been executed by series of operations given in this figure to identify the final output. So I hope you understand the different role of different operations and how the final output has been taken. Now, the various development that occurred in the CNN. Starting from the year 1988 until now, there are many developments that have been conducted in the CNN model. The very basic model of CNN is LeeNet, introduced in the year 1988. Then over the year and over the periods, we have AlexNet, ZDFNet, GoogleNet, VGGNet, ResNet, and DenseNet. Why we need to have these much nets? Why? Because it is understood that the data complexity is increasing day by day. Once the data complexity is increasing, we need to develop suitable model so that the complexity of the data is nullified and our recognition task should be very good enough to say the output. Not only that, the computing power also, power of the machine also should be capable enough to conduct such task. So see here, as the data and the computing power grown, so CNN become unavailable, so that we go for another CNN model. Once the data complexity is increasing, we go for another CNN model, so the purpose of going for various CNN model is to address the complexity of the data very perfectly. So what one has to decide? So you have data in your hand, and if the data complexity is very well addressed by LeeNet, you go with LeeNet. In case your data complexity is not addressed by LeeNet, you go for DenseNet. Otherwise, you go for AlexNet or GoogleNet. That depends on your problem and that depends on your choice. So, participant, please remember, all these net are ready-madely available as a package. Frankly speaking, they are ready-madely available as a pre-trained network. So, once you are with the problem and with the data, then the data can be fed into the pre-trained network to get your output. Or else you can start the model from the scratch. So it is up to you to decide what kind of CNN model that you are going to use for your research problem. And always you remember that for developing the CNN model, the input should be an image. Now, after understanding the CNN, if you go to your lab or if you want to do your own research work, if you have some benchmark data, say for example, the data that we have discussed in the yesterday class, sepal length, petal length, petal width, like that of normal tabular format data, then it is a structured data. For that success data, if you want to apply CNN, it is not a fair one. So you need to develop, or you need to gather, or you need to generate data in such a way that it should be addressed well by the CNN model. So with this, I close the presentation of CNN, and let me go into the next network, that is recurrent neural network. So look at the architecture. Participant, please look at the architecture. So if you see this architecture is similar to the architecture that we discussed yesterday with the for the backpropagation neural network. Then what is the difference? Can you find the difference in this architecture? Yes, exactly. The architecture here is the feedback connection from the output layer to the hidden layer. So as against the shallow network model that we have seen in the yesterday class, here there is a small change, that is a feedback connection, presence of a feedback connection from the output layer to the hidden layer. So this feedback connection makes this network to store the previous value of output. So this network always holds some sort of memory in it. Let me explain this network further in the next slide. See, what are the specialty of this network? This network is useful for what kind of data? Sequence data. This network is trained with the help of backpropagation algorithm. And this network is having a small short-term memory, which remembers the value of output in the previous stage. Then only that previous stage output is fed into the hidden layer, so that the hidden layer accepts the input along with its own value, then with the previous output value to produce a new output. Now, this new output will become the previous output. Then that previous output is utilized by the hidden layer to produce a new output. So, even though the backpropagation algorithm is used here, that is I illustrated in the yesterday class, this backpropagation algorithm depends upon the time. So, with respect to time, the backpropagation algorithm works. So the algorithm is called backpropagation through time. That is, at time t equal to 0, the output produced is some x. That x is fed as input to the hidden layer. Now, at time t1, what is the output that is to be produced? Now, that output time at time t1 is used as the input to the hidden layer for the output to be produced at time t equal to 2. Likewise, t equal to 3. So to produce the output t equal to n, you need an output at t equal to n minus 1. So the backpropagation algorithm is executed in the same way as explained in the yesterday class, but here with respect to timestamp, the algorithm is executed. So this is algorithm is called backpropagation through time. So once again, we revisit the idea of recurrent neural network. So in what way? A standard neural network is viewed as a recurrent neural network with the help of a loop, with the help of a feedback connection. So if it is a feedback connection, we can say that it is a feedback neural network. Why it is said that recurrent neural network? Because every time the output is taken, that this previous stage output is taken and it is given back throughout the algorithm execution, that is repeatedly throughout the execution, so that it is called as recurrent in nature. So here, in addition to the input that is passing from input layer to hidden layer, hidden layer to output layer, there are some signals, that is information, which a neuron can pass in the sideways also. What is meant by sideways? So if you look at the architecture, so they pass information in the sideways. So instead of this output layer that is passing the information in the forward direction, it also passes the information the sideways to the hidden layer as a feedback connection. So that's why the statement is used here. So then why the recurrent connection is meant to have some memory? Because in order to remember the output, previous state output, it should be maintained with some memory. It is called as shorter memory. And you have to remember one major thing. If you want to use a recurrent neural network, then you have to use sequential data. So if you use image data, then that image data is used to do the recognition task by CNN. And if it is sequential data, then the sequential data is fed as input to the recurrent neural network model. So what are the examples for sequential data? It is audio, video. Say for example, why it is treated as sequential data? Because at time t0, I will say hi. At time t1, I will say welcome. At time t2, I will say good afternoon. Likewise, with respect to time, my data input is varying. My data is sequentially coming, but with respect to time, the words and the sentences are varying. So those kinds of data, that is voice signal, speech signal, accordingly video frames, are all treated as sequential data. Even sometimes the image as well as the numerical data are of sequential nature. Remember, the data called temporal data, time series data, even the data generated by sensors are all generated with respect to timestamp. So they are all treated as sequential data. So if you have such data, and if that data is very huge in size, then your normal neural network is not able to do processing over the data. At that situation, you can go for using the recurrent neural network. So once again, I am going to illustrate the difference between the normal network with respect to a recurrent neural network. Look at the diagram in the left side. Look at this diagram. See, this is the one-dimensional view of a normal network that we have discussed so far. Not CNN, but BPNN, RBF, and even your SOAM, all are treated as this kind of network. So you have input layer with a set of inputs, and you have a hidden layer with a hidden number of neurons, and you have output layer with the output neurons. So remember, there is only one hidden layer. If you unfold this model, you can get n number of input nodes. Each is attached with some weight values connected to the hidden layer nodes, and each is attached with its own weight to connect to the output to produce the output. So this is the standard ANN model that we have discussed so far. But what is here in recurrent connection? Remember this one-dimensional model. We have an input. The input is attached to hidden layer node, and that hidden layer node is attached to the output node to produce the output. Remember, there is a weight value between X and H, and there is a weight value between X and Y. Remember, there is a feedback connection inside the hidden nodes with the weight value WH. So if you unfold this model, you may get H0, then H1, H2, H3. See, H0 is 1, the value that timestamp 0. This H1 is a timestamp 1, H2 a timestamp 2, H3 a timestamp 3. That means some previous state is also allowed to enter into the model. So that's why it has said to have some kind of memory in it, and it is the connection which is always recurrent in nature. So in this particular model, that is normal model, both the input and output are of vector type, and the values are fixed size. But when the case of recurrent model, the input is of series type. What is meant by series type under vector type? Vector type is fixed. Vector type is in the form of tabular form, and the value are constant, 1, 2, 3, like that. Whereas in the series type, it is continuously coming or continuously generated. So, and also the size is variable. We cannot fix the value, and it is variable in size. Also, in this normal model, you can find that the weight parameters are updated across the connection from each stage, that is hidden to input to hidden and hidden to output. Whereas here, not only the weights, but also its states are updated. Say for example, at this stage, the state is 0, but here the state is 1, and here the state is 2. But the values are not updated, the values are same weights are used again and again. Here no parameter sharing is used. See for example, X1 doesn't share any parameter with X12. But here it is not the case. X1 hidden state value H1 is shared with the second node X2. H2, the hidden state of X2 is shared with X3. Likewise, the information is shared here. And one more thing you need to think about it. Here X11, X12, X13 are individual distinct variables like sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width. They are individual distinct variables. Whereas here, this X1, X2, X3 are continuous variable from the single source. From a single source, it is continuously generating. That is, you take, for example, my voice. So if I say hello, then it is X1. Then welcome, then it is X2. And good afternoon, then it is X3. So whatever the words coming out of from my mouth, all are treated as X1, X2, X3. So they all are treated as input. So by means of that, you can decide what will be the next word that I am going to say. So that is the idea here. So in summary, we can say that a normal neural network can be converted into a recurrent neural network by means of two things. One is by maintaining a state for hidden layer, as well as by maintaining a loop for each hidden layers. So with the help of these two, that is, we can make a normal neural network to be a recurrent neural network that accepts series of inputs for producing the series of outputs. So far the network, that is here, this one, and this one, and this one, and this one, whatever the RNN we discussed so far are not deep RNN. They are simple RNN, which has only one hidden layer. Look at it. There is only one hidden layer. So even though here we have one to two hidden layers are available, so it is not treated that much deep. Because you need to have more than two or three, or you have to have n number of hidden layers, then only it is treated as deep. So far the model we have discussed is simple RNN. So how to make this simple RNN as a deep RNN? So you can make this simple RNN as a deep RNN by adding depth. How to add depth? It is simply adding the hidden layer. In what way you can add a hidden layer? There are four ways of adding hidden layer. Look at the example diagram here. See, this here one is there. So corresponding, you read the first point in this slide. So you can add hidden states one above the other. So H is one hidden state above which Z is added, above which some X, some I may be added, above which some J may be added, above which some M may be added. Likewise, you can keep on adding the hidden state so that your simple RNN will become a deep RNN. Next, what is the second way of making the deep RNN? Add additional non-linear hidden layers between input. So between input and output. See, between input and output, you have a weight called WX. Here in this place, you can add n number of hidden state. What is the third one? Within the hidden layer, you can add n number. So that is, I have H and Z as the two hidden layers. So in between H and Z, you can add hidden layers and you can keep on adding the hidden layer to make the RNN into a deep RNN. So what is the fourth one? In between H and Y, that is between a hidden state and the output state, you can add a hidden layer nodes to make the node as a deep RNN. So these are the four ways you can make the RNN as a deep RNN. Next, come to the next level of understanding the concept of RNN in terms of different connections and different number of nodes. Look at the diagram. So one to many, many to one, many to many. So what is this one to one? One input node and one output node. What is one to many? One input node, many output node. Likewise, many to one, many input node and one output node. The input nodes are represented in pink color. The hidden nodes are represented in green color. The output nodes are represented in blue color. So what is this about? So if you develop a deep RNN, and if your deep RNN has one input node and many output node, for what purpose it can be used? And if your deep RNN have many input nodes but only one output node, then for what purpose it is used? Likewise, we are in a position to decide before getting into the RNN model. Let me take the first model, one to one. So this one-to-one model is not an RNN at all. It is a simple BPN or simple RBFN or SOM, whatever it may be. So because it is going to accept fixed size input and a fixed size output. So it is not a RNN. Otherwise, it is called a vanilla mode of processing the RNN without recurrent connection. If you say an RNN, it should have recurrent connection. If you say RNN without recurrent connection, then it is not an RNN, it is a simple BPN or RBFN, depend upon the training algorithm or activation function used. So this is image classification. So yesterday I discussed about a face recognition with respect to BPN model, that is this architecture. Next, coming to the second one. one to many. One input is there, and you are going to produce many output. See here, this hidden layer is having recurrent connection. How the recurrent connections are introduced? By means of the arrow in the horizontal direction. So here, what might be the output? The output is sequence output, but the input is single input. So what kind of application this kind of RNN model can be used? Look at it. This kind of RNN model can be used for a task called image captioning. So a single image is introduced in the input layer. If whereas in the output, we can get many output. That is image captioning task. It is very familiar with you. So if you are in social media, in Facebook, you can heard about the task called tagging. So person tagging, that is when a group photo or when there is so many persons are available. And if you want to tag one person, so those kind of tasks are treated as image captioning. If you want to conduct such task, then you can go for such kind of connections with respect to RNN. Next, come to many to one. So input is many nodes and output is one. So what kind of application this kind of RNN can be used? This is used for sentiment analysis. See, in the input node, we have many sentiments. So each input node takes the sentiments of each person. So every person can have their own views or in a particular incident. If they post their views, all their individual views are treated as input. So the input will have many opinions, but finally we have to take only one output. Those output will say whether that opinions are positive or negative, or whether their analysis sentiments are positive sentiments or negative sentiments. So this kind of connections, which is having many input nodes with one output node, is used for sentiment analysis. Next connection, many to many connection. So what is the application for this many to many connection? So that is, you have many input nodes and many output nodes. It means that you have to give sequential input data and you are expecting sequential output data. So the application for this many to many connection is machine translation. So what is mean by machine translation? So it is nothing but translation of language from one form to another form. Remember, language translation, that is feature available in Google. So if you give any input that is of the form particular language, then this kind of RNN accepts that input, process that input via hidden state, and produces the output in some other language. See, machine translation. And RNN reads the sentence in English and then outputs a sentence in French. So if you want to develop such kind of application for language translation or for language conversion or speech to language conversion, then you can use this kind of RNN model, many to many connection. See here, here also many to many connection, but what is the difference between this many to many connection and this many to many connection is with respect to input. See, you need to identify the difference between sequence input and synchronized sequence input. So sequence input is the one which is coming out sequentially one by one, but there is no synchronization. There is no connection between the first input and the next input. Whereas in synchronized sequence input, there is a connection between the first input and the next sequence of input with respect to time. The best example is your video frame. So if that case, if you give a video frame here, then you can identify the scene behind the video frame and you can tag what kind of scene it is. So the best example is whenever a movie is playing, whenever some kind of drug addict scene has come, you need to display a caption. So those are the best example for this kind of RNN connection. So we have many different flavors of RNN connection, and each flavor of RNN connection have been used for a specific application. So the one to many is used for image tagging or captioning. Many to one is used for sentimental analysis, and many to many is used for machine translation, and many to many with synchronized sequence input is for used for video understanding or video scene detection or simply video classification. Now let me discuss about some problems associated with deep RNN. So far we have discussed the RNN model, that RNN models are treated as deep RNN model. But they are yet simple model only. So we are not into it advanced model. Why? Because is the simple deep RNN model suffers from some weakness. What are the three weaknesses associated with the simple deep RNN model? Is the memory is very short term. Also the gradient. What is meant by gradient? The del value. And I explained the yesterday class, new weight is find out by old weight plus change in weight. So the new weight plus equal to old weight plus change in that change in weight is treated as gradient. So the gradient is always calculated during the learning process, and the gradient value between old weight and the new weight can be any value which should be a reasonable value. So what is mean by a vanishing one? While conducting the learning process, if the gradient gets slow and slow and slow and slow value over the period, then it doesn't have an impact on producing the output. At that time, your neural network doesn't take that gradient or omit that gradient value, and it doesn't perform well or producing the output. So if your gradient shrink, means the synced gradient, that is very small value gradient, doesn't have a great impact on producing the output. So you should avoid the problem of shrinking the gradient value over the learning process. Next, exploding gradient. Exploding gradient is just opposite to the vanishing gradient. That is, while updating the gradient value, that is, while calculating the gradient value del W, there are some situation the gradient will get enormous value. That is, it will increase the value exponentially without the limit of the expectation. So it means it is becoming very large. It will begin to overflow. Sometimes it may go into infinity value. That means NaN value. So at that time, your neural network not able to handle such a very big gradient. At that time, what happened is your neural network will become unstable, and it is not able to learn the data properly, leading to poor output. So these are all the three problems associated with the simple deep RNN. So what we have discussed so far, so recurrent neural network, and at this up to this point, the recurrent neural network is not a deep recurrent neural network. So here only I introduced a deep recurrent neural network by increasing the connections. And in deep neural network, what are the various possible connections are available, and what are the various applications that can be used for deep RNN? And here the problems with the simple deep RNN. So in order to avoid these problems, the researchers are going with two popular and widely used model. They are called by the name long short-term memory and a gradient recurrent unit, that is LSTM RNN, GRU RNN. So LSTM RNN and GRU RNN are specialized RNN in which each neuron have been designed in such a way that it does its own operation based on the operation defined in it. So look at the LSTM node. This is one single neuron treated in the form of LSTM operation. It contains a sigmoidal activation function, tanH operation function. It does the point-wise multiplication and point-wise addition and a vector concatenation. So some kind of mathematical operation is defined to make the short-term memory to prolong for some amount of time so that it won't get lost during the learning process. So that's why it's called long short-term memory. Likewise, you have another unit called gated rectifier unit. Here also some mathematical operation is gated recurrent unit. Here also some mathematical operation is defined by some activation function sigmoidal and a tanH activation function with respect to some operations. So this is the unit of neuron when you use the GRU RNN. So these two units are specialized units, defined mathematical operations, using which the problems associated with the normal simple RNN have been rectified. Of course, many of the application in today's scenario, like speech recognition, speech synthesis, text generation, even caption bar video that I explained in the previous slide, all can be done very effectively with these kind of two networks. Then what is the difference between these two networks? LSTM is little slow when compared with gated recurrent unit. Gated recurrent unit lacks in the concept of memory when compared with long short-term memory network. So both are competitive one another, and you can use the model as per your requirement. If you want the response in a faster way with no requirement in memory, only short-term memory is needed, then you can go for GRU. Or if you want memory to be retained for a long time, then only you can produce the effective output, means then you can go for LSTM network. So all I want to convey to you is these two networks who gives the more powerful support for the deep RNN model. Participants, with this I close the session. There are still further ideas are available to discuss with you. All are mathematically related. So with this 1 hour session, I can't convey everything. Hopefully I will try to convey those operations in the lab session. If you want to explore further information related with this presentation, you can notice that in each slide I have given a source like this. So these are all some online resource materials, so you can use these online resource material to explore further for your problems. So with this I close this session. So if you have any question, I think I am in a position to answer your question. Participant, please, you can raise your hands so that I can answer your question. Yes, ma'am. Arpita. Arpita have gone. Yes, ma'am. Shamim Fatima. Post your question. Your question is not audible. Sorry, ma'am, your voice is not audible to me. I think something have happened in the middle. Your voice is breaking. It is not clearly audible.
Yes, sir.
No, ma'am. So, no, sorry, your voice is breaking. I am not getting you very clearly. What I can do is. So what I can give you is, you are posting your queries in the chat window. Even then, I am not in a position to answer your question right now. So I will give my mail ID so that you can post your queries. I can answer your question. Participants, you can note it down my email ID. You can post any queries or any doubt for so far the classes that we have discussed. I can answer your queries. So note it down. Because of network issues and other problems, I couldn't get clearly the question raised by you. Organizer. Hello, sir.
Sir.
So shall we stop this session for a while, for maybe for 5 to 10 minutes, then we will resume for lab session.
Okay, sir. No problem.
I want little break.
Okay, sir. No problem, sir.
Okay. So participant, we will resume after maybe in another 5 minutes. Now the time is 2:46. Maybe at time 2:51, we will start the session, the practical session, how to implement CNN and RNN with respect to MATLAB software. Okay, thank you.
Shall we start?
Yes, sir, we can start, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir. So participants, I welcome you to the practical session of today's theory session, that is deep neural network and convolutional neural network and recurrent neural network. So as discussed in the very first day of our class, that is in the agenda, so this is just a demo session only, because this needs latest version of MATLAB. MATLAB version 2019 is required to understand the process. Some may have doubts whether this model can be implemented in Python. Yes, of course, you can implement the same in Python. But however, I am very comfortable and familiar with the MATLAB software. So I am going to give demo on MATLAB software only. You please listen to the idea that is discussed here. If you are interested, then later take this idea to your workbench and you carry out further into it. Or you can read a separate package with respect to Python or other software. You can do it, the CNN and RNN model development. So I have shared you one URL in the chat window. Participants, you can take it. You can Google it and paste it to know what is the content given in that URL. So actually, this is the content. Create a simple deep learning neural network for classification. So this is the content available in MathWorks website for the version 2019. And we are going to see the code given in this version. And I am going to execute the code in this version in the MATLAB software. So to understand the code, you need to understand the code in terms of five phases. See, look at it. Load and explore image data. Define the network structure. Specify the training option. Train the network. And finally, predict the labels of new data and calculate the classification accuracy. So you have to do these five stages to make the final model for classification. Actually, what this demo is about, this demo is going to classify the handwritten characters. What are the handwritten characters are? See, number 0 to number 9. So those characters are there. For each character, 1000 images. That is number 0, 1000 images. Number 2, 1000 images. Number 3, 1000 images. Likewise, number up to number 9, 1000 images. So totally 10,000 images are there. Out of the 10,000 images, as I said earlier, whenever you want to develop a ANN model, you need to divide the data set into two categories. One is for training, another one is for testing. So for each category, 750 images is taken for training and 250 images is left for testing. So totally how many images have we taken for training on the whole? So 2750 for each category means 10 into 750, that is 7,500 images have been taken for testing, and 2,500 images are left for testing. 7,500 for training and 2,500 for testing. So to start with, the first step is load and explore the image data. So this is the statement used to load the data. See, here you are mentioning the path name, digit dataset path. So we are going to use the example dataset available in the MATLAB software, that digit dataset. So the dataset path is mentioned here. Then from that path, the data is loaded into the variable IMDS. So I will copy these two lines and paste it in MATLAB software. I copied. Now I stop the screen share and share the screen share to MATLAB software. I hope the MATLAB screen is visible to you. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now you to start with the program, what to do? So I said the yesterday class, file, new, or you can type the script window, new script window. New script window has been opened. Here I can paste the program. So what is the first two line? The first two line is about, first line is about understand taking the path where the data is available in the MATLAB software. The second line is about storing the data into the variable IMDS. See, it is not, if you want to learn line by line, it is very easier. If you want to study each line, then you can help select the line and make a help on selection. Say, for example, select this line. If you want to know what is full file, means select the line, right click on it. If you have opened help on full file, then it means some help file is open. Here you can study what is the purpose of a full file and what are the arguments available, how to use it. So as a standard style, I am using these three line, CLC, clear all and close all. So for executing this program, so what I have to do, saving the file first. So I'm going to save the file. I can save in any location. So I'm going to save in the desktop for clarity. CNN, I'm saving it. CNN. So I'm storing it in the name CNN. Now I will execute up to this line. What has happened? The image matrix is loaded into IMDS. Look at the workspace window. No variables here. So now I am going to execute. See, the image gets, the line gets executed. So the path has been taken and the image data store has been created. That is, from the path, the image has been taken and it is stored as a data store inside the MATLAB environment in which you are writing a program. Next line. So I am stopping this MATLAB screen and going into the that page. Yes, sample network. So here next line is display some of the image in the data store. So if you want to display a few images in the data store, you can use this code, copy this code and you paste here. So what is this line is about? This line is 10th line. This line is creating a figure window. Here some random permutation is created. Why some random number is created? Because randomly we are picking some images from the data store in order to visualize. We are plotting the window subplot, four rows and five columns. We are dividing it, four rows and five columns. Accordingly, the image is going to be placed for each location, that is for each I, images have been displayed. So totally how many images have been taken? I think 20 images have to be taken, 4x5. Four rows, five columns, that means 20 images. So out of the 10,000 images of the original data, in order to visualize, 20 images have been randomly taken and it is displayed for understanding purpose. So let me execute this file. So I think I am not sharing the screen, very sorry. I am stopping the screen and I once again enter into MATLAB session. See, I copied the code. This line figure is for creating a figure window, randomly generating some points out of 10,000 points, and those points are used inside the for loop to choose a particular image, and it has been used for display purpose. I will run the program. So it is run already. Run the program once again. See, some random images have been taken. Four rows, five columns. Here, subplot 4,5. That means four rows and five columns. And each column I, you have to store a file. So that file is taken as IMShow. IMShow is the command which displays the image, and it is taken from the image store. What is the name of the image store? IMDS. IMDS. Dot files. The corresponding file has to be taken with the value. What I value has been generated, that I value has been taken here. So if you want to know how many I values are generated, you can do that one also. Just you omit the semicolon. See, in MATLAB software, I forgot to tell this one. If you omit the semicolon, then that output is displayed in the command window. So like C or C++, if you are familiar with that, if you omit semicolon, error will occur. But in the case of MATLAB, if you omit the semicolon, that output will be displayed here. So now once again, I'm going to display the run this code. See, what is the perm value? It is random permutation of 10,000 commas. So 20 values have been taken from the 10,000 value. That means 4,388th image
3816th image, 7654th image. So those images have been taken. So what is this image? This image is 4388. What is this image? This image is 3816th image. Likewise, the image is taken and it is displayed. For simplicity, I close this. So this is the way in which you display the file. Let me stop this MATLAB screen and go back to this screen, that is demo screen. So after that, you need to have one task, that is just to check how many categories are there in the data and how many images are there in the each category. Since it is a predefined data, you already know that there are totally 10 digits are there, starting from 0 to 9. And each digit 1000 values are there. Suppose in case if you are developing your own problem, then if you are going to collect any data, say for example, it may be a medical data. So you do not know how many patients records are available and how many images are available for each patients. In such a case, you can use this variable, count each label IMDS. IMDS is nothing but the data store. That data store count each label will gives you the label count for each category. So the output is this. We will execute it there for a while. Let me explain all these things. Then IMG. IMG is the variable which read the image from the image store. That is read image. Why this command is used? Because we want to know what is the size of the image. What is the pixel size of the image? So this pixel size of the image is 28 cross 28. So you imagine the, think about the convolution operation we perform. We perform the convolution operation for understanding with the 5 cross 5 matrix. Here, what is the size of the matrix? 28 cross 28. How many channels are there? Since it is a grayscale image, the channel is 1. If it is a RGB image, that is color image, then it should be 3. So 28, 28. Why we should know the pixel value, that is image size? Because this image size should be the first parameter to be given in the input for the CNN model creation. So before that, you need to know the size of the image so that this command is used. Then the data is divided as a training, that is 750 data for each category is divided. This command split each label is meant to divide the data into training and testing. IMDS train holds the training data. How many training data? 750 for each category, that is 7500. And IMDS validation, how many data for testing? 2500. So after having done this, you need to do the network architecture. So let me explain this later for a while. We will copy this code and run the code in the software. So what is the first line after that? Label count. Label count. Then image size to understand what is the size of the image so that we can use it in the convolutional layer creation. Then and number of training and testing data. Training and testing data. Okay. So now I'm going to execute the file. See, the same output has come here. Each label is the how many number of data, what is the size of the matrix, right? So I'm going to stop the screen and go to the MATLAB screen, web page screen. So after that, you have to define the architecture. So for architecture, first you should define the layer. So how many number of layers? It is decided on the AC, one convolution layer, and pooling layer, second convolution layer, pooling layer, and convolution layer, and fully connected layer, softmax layer, classification. Likewise, you design. So if you want to have help of this each and every, again, you can right click on help, you can give it. So not here in the MATLAB software. Or if you want to help
just to copy it here, and if you paste it here, then means it will give you the meaning of this statement. See, what is convolution 2D layer will be useful. So you can understand the convolution 2D layer very well. So its syntax is given with the various parameters associated with this. You can go through it. You can understand that. Then you can modify according to your need and requirement. So this is the statement which is used to create the architecture, that is convolutional neural network architecture. First layer is input layer, convolution layer. See the size, padding is up, performed. See the size 3x8, that is a feature size. That is filter, so kernel size is 3 and the size of the map is 8. So next hidden layer, size of the map is 16 and size of the map is 32. Patch normalization is performed and then ReLU operation is performed. You can understand these operations in this demo page of MATLAB software. What is this layer is about? What is this layer? Likewise, you can develop. So we can use this for defining the network architecture. Later, I will go to the MATLAB scheme by copying the code. Then training option. First, you need to give the training option. What is the method? See the example. What is the training algorithm? Scaled gradient descent method. That is your backpropagation algorithm. So you have to mention all other parameters that are required. What is the goal? 0.01 is the goal. Likewise, you have to mention all the things before training. Once you have once the training option have been trained, then train network. Train network is the command used to train the network. See here, IMDS training data is given, CNN layer is given, and the training option is given. So all these three things are given in the training network. Now net is the one that is the trained network. So once you done this, your training screen will look like this. That is a training output screen will be look like this. After that, you can go for testing you can go for getting the final output. So let me stop this screen and go to the MATLAB screen. So you have to copy this layers. Layers. And you have to copy the option. Option. And you have to copy this one. Net training. See, these three stages we have copied. One is layer creation, training option creation, and the network training. So now we are going to run the program. I am going to run the program. Let me see the output here. The output window screen is visible to you. Are you seeing the screen of training progress? So here you can get how many validation accuracy, starting time, epoch cycle, and all these things you got. So only thing, you have to decode the value and write the paper accordingly. I hope you followed the screen of the training screen for training performance. So let me stop this screen and I go for discussing the other lines. What is this? Yes, this one. So the final one is classify validation images and compute accuracy. You one can have some doubts in it, where the training process conducted and how much time it is be taking and what is whether any GPU is required or not. See here, by default, train network uses the GPU because of the availability of parallel computing toolbox here, as well as the facility of CUDA available with this MATLAB 2019 version. If it is very by default. If you want, you can, if your system is very capable enough computationally, then you can use your own CPU, for which you have to set the execution environment, for which also methods are available, and you can use those methods for your clarity. So the final prediction, that is the final output. So classify is the one which is used to understand the final testing output. So this is equivalent to the sim command that we used in the yesterday program. So you have to use this. After that, you have to use some formula that is here for calculating the accuracy. So after that, we will display the accuracy here. So let me copy this. I will stopping the screen. I'm sharing the screen once again to MATLAB. So here I am pasting that value. So I am closing all the previous windows. Participants, are you seeing the subscreen of MATLAB output? Sir, are you following with me? Okay, so do you participant, have you seen the output screen, training screen? Training screen is visible? Training screen is visible to you? Because I have to change the screen setting.
Sir?
So I am asking, training screen is visible, MATLAB screen is visible now, right?
Yes, sir. Yes,
so sir. Once I run the program, some kind of subscreen will be open. Whether that subscreen is displayed?
No, sir.
The subscreen is not displayed?
No, sir. No, sir.
So only the MATLAB screen is displayed to you, right?
Yes, sir.
So, okay. I will try to show that screen. If I stop, try to stop that screen. I am running the program. Run. So the process is started. See, the program is executing. Now the screen is visible, I guess.
Yes, sir.
The training progress curve was seen to you. Participants, I hope you see the screen. So the training will take some time because we have 10,000 images, right? So 7,500 images for training and 2,500 images for testing. So this is the way the training has been conducted. See how much epoch. So epoch wise, epoch, how we reached the destination, that is how much we reached the maximum accuracy and the minimum loss. These are the two curves. So other parameters are shown here. So you can use it for writing your paper. So I will share the MATLAB screen. So final accuracy is 98.72. So this is the way you can decode the accuracy. I hope you understand the idea here, that demo that I have shown for convolutional neural network. So I have given the URL. So that URL, you can use it for further understanding. And there are other examples are also available in the MATLAB software. he see here some other examples like class related topics. If you go to related topics, so you can have other values, learn about convolutional neural networks, specify layers of setup parameters. So those things are again available, and you can learn those things and you can modify the model. So in case if you got any parameter that is to be tuned, the MathWorks are in a position to support you to tune the parameter as well as to find the ideal values for the things. And also you can surf these deep learning neural network toolbox. See here, deep learning. So many worked out examples are there. So many demos are there. So you can go through the demos. You can run every demos and you can understand very well about the application, how to execute this. So someone asked me in the first day class, I guess, whether the MATLAB software can be connected with MATLAB, so connected with the cloud. See, deep learning in parallel and in the cloud. So I heard that the many of the facilities have been added with the latest MATLAB version, so that any kind of task can be easily carried out with less effort when compared with other languages. The only thing is, huge amount of this copyright software. That is the problem with the when compared with other software like Python, which is so. See, here one line is given. You can also exchange model with the TensorFlow and Python PyTorch through ONX format. See, if you develop MATLAB code, so no problem. You can develop the MATLAB code and you can use this MATLAB code into TensorFlow or PyTorch code by means of some exchange model. That kind of facilities is also available. And you can have some pre-trained models. See, DarkNet, ResNet, NSENet, SqueezeNet, some pre-trained models are also available. And you can use those pre-trained models, GoogleNet, for your cases. So MATLAB software seems to be very easier for you to understand many of the situations that is very complex task. You can easily understand, you can easily use it for your research problem so that some kind of clarity can be produced. So with this, I'll stop the explaining the CNN network. Let me go for DNN, for which I am stopping the screen. Participants, I am sharing you one more URL which explains you about deep RNN. So I shared that one. If you are in different laptop, you can open that. If you are in mobile listening to the video, you can later open this to understand. So let me give you a demo on that. So this is a recurrent neural network. This recurrent neural network is used for time series prediction. This is a long shorter LSTM network, not a simple deep RNN model, LSTM network. So here you have the same like I explained for CNN. So many stages the data is explained first. It is a chicken box data set. Probably in another 3 months period or another 6 month period, if you got a COVID-19 data set with respect to time frame, with respect to day, with respect to week or month, you can use those data also for studying the data that is with the help of LSTM network. So this demo will be explaining about how LSTM model can be developed for a sequence data with respect to chickenpox disease. So this data is an example data available in the MATLAB software. So first the data is loaded, that is load sequence data. Data is loaded and you got the output. And then you are going to standardize the data. That means normalize the data. Then you have to prepare predictors and responses. That means what is the predictor and what is the response. That means what is the y value and what is the x value. That is set of input and output. That is the predictor. In terms of regression, the name predictor is given to signify input variables. The name response is given to signify output variable. So here the LSTM structure is defined. The LSTM structure is defined. See, many layers have been sequence input layer, LSTM layer, fully connected layer, regression layer, and training option is given. So train LSTM. If you train the LSTM, so this kind of screen will be coming as a part of the training. Then the forecast, that means prediction, how much accurate the prediction is that step is conducted by
these set of codes. It is easier. If you go through the code, you can easily understand with the idea that I explained in the theoretically. So you can easily...
Sir, excuse me, sir.
Yes?
Sir, screen is not visible.
Really?
Yes.
Okay. Now it is visible?
Yes, sir. Now it is.
So once again, I am making the explanation faster. Time series forecasting using deep learning. That is, this demo, you are going to see how long short-term memory network, LSTM network, is used for time series data analysis. So the data that is used is chickenpox data set. So to start the model development, first you have to load the data. Then you have to normalize the data that is standardized, predict the, prepare the input variable and output variable from the data. That is called predictor is input, response is output. So then define the structure, that is LSTM network structure using this set of code. Then make the training option, that is set the value, maximum number of epochs, gradient value, goal, and every other values you have to design. Then this function is used to train the network. Once the training is started, you can visualize the screen. Then finally, you have to get the output. That is how much predicted the value is and what is the accuracy and how much mean square error we got. Finally, you can also do some kind of plot, how much prediction has been done. So these many plots are visible for each case. Instead of, I think it is self-explanatory. If you go through each and every one, you can understand. Before that, yeah, try to understand my presentation in the theoretical part. And then you come to this, you can understand well. Each and every code can be easily explained with the help of help. Maybe after this demo is over, if you try this program in your personal laptop or personal lab, if you face any difficulty or if you face any error, you can mail me or you can text me. I may be in a position to clarify your doubts. So for the time shot, let me stop the demo here. Let me go to the MATLAB software. I will execute the program and I will make you to know what exactly the output is coming with the help of sequence data. So what type of model it is here? That is many to one. This is many to one model. That is many sequence information we are giving it. And what is the output we are getting? Only one output, whether the data, disease is present or not. So this is the one another example for sentimental analysis. So many sequence input data is given with respect to each one's sentiments. And finally, we are going to say whether the sentiments is positive or negative. Likewise, with respect to disease, many sequences data, that is many person's history, month-wise or day-wise or date-wise will be given to it. And according to the historical data presented to the network will say whether the person is having disease or not, to what level that he will be processing the disease. That is the idea of this demo. So let me stop the screen and I will switch over to MATLAB. So I have already copied the program. Let me open that program. Open and desktop here. Desktop is only. Yes, or not. So whatever the code that we have seen just now in the MATLAB demo page, I have copied all those code here. It is self-explanatory when you go through each and every code. If you not understand the code, just to open it, right-click the code, help on selection, it will give you help about that statement. You know, nothing to worry about it. Now I am going to run the program. Run. If you run the program, you will get this mini screen regarding to training. So I will stop the screen and I will go to the screen where you got the training curve. Yes. So do you see the training progress curve? I think now I am scaring the screen. So totally 250 epochs we maintain. We are reaching the 81 epoch, 85 epoch, 90, the epoch is going on. Accordingly, the curve training process is shown. So the above curve is the one which says the root mean square error value. The below one is the one which is showing the loss. So we have come to 157th epoch.
So it's still going on. So once it reaches the epoch or one reaches the landing, you see the landing rate pi not not one, iterations per epoch one, maximum iteration 50. So the three lines are the dark line is a training line, that is smooth through training line. See some other screen have been displayed. So what are the screen that are displayed are? So I will stop the screen. And I will once again stop and I will share the screen. So these are the other screens that has got root mean square error value forecast with updates like that. So likewise, there are many screens that are coming out from the simulation. The main screen is the training screen to understand the training process, and other screens are the final screen which makes you to display the output in a well-behaved manner. See, this, look at the screen. The first blue line is the one which is the observed value, that is the actual value from the data. The second red line is the one which is the predicted value. So look at the behavior of both the curve. Both the curve looks similar in the pattern of peaks and downs. So it means that ideally your predicted value is closest with the actual value, which can clearly conveys that your RNN model exactly predicts the category who is affected by the chickenpox or not based on the historical information of a patient. So I am stopping the screen and I am once again getting into the MATLAB screen. Yes. So this is the way in which RNN approach. So if you look at the workspace window, you can find all those things. See, like yesterday, we have developed the data. See, X train. This is the training data. See, sequence data, training data. And this is the testing data. X test is the testing data. And Y test, Y train is the training data. And Y test is the testing data, testing output. And Y prediction is the prediction. So what is the thing is that two curve we have drawn, right? So that drawn is between Y test and Y predicted. Y predicted is the one which is given by the network model, which is in the orange color. And Y test is the actual one, which is in the blue color. For both of the thing, the graph is drawn. What else I have to explain? I think it's more than sufficient. One thing you need to explore further from this idea, the code is self-explanatory. Even if you don't know, you can get any help from either from me or from the web page, or you can go with the MathWorks community. If you develop any code and if you encounter any problem, they can surely help you, or else I am in a position to help you further to make out of this kind of stuff. So with this, I close the today's session. I will going to stop the screen. And if you have any doubts, you can ask me. And I am in a position to clarify your doubts. Participants, if you have any question. You have any question you can ask? Please raise the hands. So if you're not having any question, then I think we will end up the session. Yes, Kamalini Subramani. Yes, ma'am. Ask your question. It is not possible to unmute them. You can unmute and ask the question.
Hello.
Yes,
ma'am. Can you hear? Good afternoon, sir.
Yes. Good afternoon.
Sir, in what type of applications we can use LSTM and GRU models?
Yeah, that's what I explained in the different flavors of RNN. You just go through that slide. Different flavors of RNN. There we saw many connections. Based on the connections between the input and output and hidden, you can use a different model. So in all the cases, you can go for LSTM. So why we go for LSTM is instead to have long memory, memory. So you can have sentiment analysis. You can do image captioning. You can do machine translation, or you can do video classification. All these four kinds of tasks you can do. Provided you should look for the connection. Provided you can look for the connection. So with the LSTM as well as with the GRU, you can go for these kind of tasks. Provided you have to take the connections. So you just go through the slide which explains the different flavors of RNN. There it is clearly explained. If your connection is this, then you can go for this kind of application. If your connection is this, then you can go for this kind of application like this. It is explained in that slide. So once you choose the connection, then it is up to you to decide whether you go for simple RNN or LSTM RNN or gated recurrent RNN. So there are three different RNN are available. Simple, LSTM or gated. So according to the connection, you choose the application. Then you choose the model based on your performance that you are expecting. So normally simple RNN is not giving that much performance, but LSTM is giving very good performance. But the limitation of the LSTM is it is not fast. When you want when you want to get very faster results or faster response, then you can go for GRU, gated recurrent.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. So is there any question?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, tell me, sir. What's your name?
Why we are going to validate sir? Already we are giving totally trained the data set, and we are going to test the data set. Yes. Yeah, so in between, why we are taking the validation set? What is its significance, sir?
Let me explain this scenario with respect to your classroom model,
sir.
So in a classroom, if you are teaching a student, what is the stage is called with respect to machine learning? That is, student is learning, right? Sir. Student is learning. That is, you are giving training to the student by teaching the subject, and the student is set to learn the subject, right? And finally, how do you assess the knowledge of the student? By giving some test,
sir.
Right? So to assess the knowledge of the student, one exam is sufficient. That is, end semester exam is sufficient to analyze the to understand the knowledge of the students gained in the subject. But between the teaching and end semester examination, you are conducting some class test, right? So what is the purpose of conducting the class test? Whether your student have understood the subject, what you have what you have taught so far. If not, you are giving some additional care, or if not, you are giving some additional additional material or additional care, or you can categorize the student into so many groups, that is weak learner, good learner, like that. So that stage is called validation.
So right, sir.
Likewise, when you want to make a machine to learn, so training and testing is not alone sufficient. So during the training process, some data from the testing has to be taken, and the model is validated during the training, like your internal assessment test. Validated.
Understood, sir.
During the validation, you came to know that even though the model performs well in the training, there are certain cases your model may fail. So in which case your model is failing, accordingly, you can tune the parameter. So validation is required.
Right, sir. Nice explanation, sir. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, is there any other explanation? Any other question? Or any other explanation you want?
What's going to say? Any other questions?
So I think we stop the session, sir.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. No problem, sir.
Okay.
Sir, for tomorrow's session, we will start a sharply at 10:30 a.m. sir.
Yeah, yes sir, yes sir, sure.
For the participants, I will send the link, Zoom link, attendance, everything. I will mail and also through WhatsApp. I will send you. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.